Hello, my name is Huma Rana, and I'm a cancer geneticist and the clinical director of cancer genetics and prevention at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston, Massachusetts. Today, I will be discussing the benefits of germline genetic testing. My talk is called I Have Cancer, Should I Have Genetic Testing? The outline of my talk is that we will discuss why germline genetic testing may be important, what germline genetic testing includes, and how it is done. Today, I'll be focusing on the benefits and concerns related to the testing of cancer survivors, as well as new testing modalities, and really giving you the ins and outs of how testing is done. Cancer is a multifactorial disease or process. It is caused by a culmination of things, age being one of them, environmental exposures, genetics, so meaning the genes that one inherits, also family history, lifestyle risk factors, and chance. Cancer is a genetic disease. Normal cells and cancer cells contain the same 20,000 genes. What distinguishes them is which genes are turned on and off. So normal cells have the same genes that cancer cells have, but cancer cells will turn on genes called oncogenes, which allow them to grow or proliferate, and cancers will turn off genes that are called tumor suppressor genes, and those are genes that would keep them from that type of rapid growth. About 10 to 15% of cancers overall are associated with an inherited genetic risk. The more germline genetic testing that we do among individuals, the more we find that there are inherited mutations in people with all sorts of different types of cancers. This is one study from our colleagues at Memorial Sloan Kettering showing that up to 12.5% of individuals who underwent genetic testing of their tumor, as well as their blood, so their inherited DNA, were found to have inherited mutations. What was interesting about the study was that it showed us that there may be a real disconnect between the genes that we find mutations in and the type of cancer individuals have. And so that was very eye-opening for many of us, and it made us realize that we should do far more genetic testing than has been previously done. This is a very simplified version of cancer genetics. Here we see a textbook pedigree or textbook family history. You see that men are in squares and women are in circles. And in this pedigree or in this family history, you see a pattern of women with breast cancers and ovarian cancers. And there are cancers in really every generation. Here you have a man who inherited the same mutation. He's an unaffected carrier who then passes down the mutation to his daughter who has breast cancer. So this is really a classic textbook pedigree. And this, we know, is not how things work in real life. So when we did have families that were so easily identifiable, we would often recommend testing of one or two genes only, but a lot has changed in cancer genetics. The cost of testing has gone down considerably. We've learned much more about many different genes associated with cancer, and we are able to test people through what we call broad sort of pan-cancer panels. It's still the most helpful, though, for us in cancer genetics to test people in the family who have had cancers. So you may be wondering, why would someone want to be tested? Germline genetic testing is important, and it's important throughout the course of one's cancer care. It can be important right at the time of diagnosis because it can help to inform what type of surgery someone should have. It can help to inform what type of treatment is best. There are more and more precision medications or precision therapeutics that are used. It can help to answer why did I develop cancer? And that can be profoundly helpful and provide closure. It can also alert people to the fact that they may have future risks or additional risks for cancer. It can help to let people know that there may be risks to their siblings, to their children, to their nieces or nephews. And most importantly, we know that screening and prevention are often available and may save lives. Other considerations, and I call this the not so fast slide, are that people have a choice about this. So not everybody wants to have germline genetic testing, and that's okay. Some people may find the information to be depressing, sad, or cause them anxiety. People may be concerned about insurance discrimination. However, for most patients who have cancer or who have had cancer, this won't make any difference. Sometimes people don't, especially in the survivor population, they may not want to revisit a difficult time or experience that they've had in the past. And sometimes people avoid germline genetic testing because there's the potential to feel guilt over transmission of a mutation or inherited cancer risk to family members. However, I often reassure my patients and make sure that people know, you know, we pass down lots of genes, we pass down lots of very wonderful traits and some traits that are associated with risk, and we have no control over any of it. I'd mentioned earlier the simplified pedigree, but we know that in real life, this is not how our families with inherited mutations present. Cancer genetics in the real world can mean that there's no family history of cancers. This is often because families can be very small. So in this family, there's only two men, and so we don't, on the father's side of the family, and so we don't know about things like breast or ovarian cancers. People may not have lived very long because of other reasons, and sometimes there are missed mutations in a family because individuals who had cancer generations prior did not have the opportunity to have genetic testing. We know that if we identify mutations in some genes, such as BRCA1 and BRCA2, that those mutations are associated with very high risk for certain types of cancers, including breast cancer, where the risk among BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutation carriers is anywhere from 50 to 85%, often an earlier age at diagnosis. Also, there's increased risk for a second breast cancer. We call that contralateral breast cancer. There's also increased risk for ovarian cancers among women with BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations. All individuals with BRCA2 mutations have increased risk for pancreatic cancers, somewhere in the lifetime risk range of 3 to 5%. There's an increased risk for melanoma. Men with BRCA mutations or BRCA2 mutations can have very aggressive prostate cancers. Men with BRCA2 mutations are also at an increased risk for breast cancers. So having this type of information or knowing this information in somebody who's a survivor can help us to screen them differently going forward. What does our screening entail? While our surveillance for BRCA1 and 2 mutation carriers is very different from what's done in the general population or in people without an inherited mutation. We begin doing breast MRIs for breast cancer risk in women. We add we begin this at age 25. We add mammograms at age 30, and we alternate the two every 6 months. We do clinical breast exams. Men begin having PSA and digital rectal exams beginning at an earlier age. And then in certain families, at least ones where there is a known history of pancreatic cancers, we have investigational pancreatic surveillance or screening that we offer with endoscopic ultrasounds and MRIs of the pancreas. Women can choose to have preventive surgeries to reduce their risk of developing breast cancer. And we know that bilateral mastectomies reduce the risk of developing a breast cancer by over 90%. And we do endorse risk-reducing surgeries to remove the ovaries and the fallopian tubes because of the higher rate of ovarian cancers in women with BRCA mutations and due to the inadequate screening or lack of effective screening for ovarian cancers. I'll talk about what genetic testing entails next. So this is a picture of a cell, and every cell that has a nucleus actually contains DNA within the nucleus of the cell. So chromosomes are made up, chromosomes which live in the nucleus, are made up of very, very long strands of DNA. Think of DNA like a book of recipes. Sections of this DNA make up individual genes. We have about 20,000. We have about 20,000 genes or recipes within every cell of our body. And the cell is able to read the recipes of our genes and build proteins that we need to function. So genes determine our eye color, our hair color, and they also control how cells live and die. The proteins that genes make work with each other, and they also interact with environmental influences. This is a closer look at the genetic code or the recipe for making a protein. The code is in A, T, C, and G. And this is the specific recipe, for example, for the BRCA2 gene. Genetic testing checks the spelling of our genes. And here, these are just examples that are not using the real genetic code. And then there's normal variation in the genetic code. So here you can see that we've spelled theater two different ways, but the word means the same thing, meaning the protein encoded carries out the same function, even though there's a change in the spelling here. A misspelling or error in the code is what we call a mutation. So we call these types of changes pathogenic variants or mutations within the genetic code. And so when you go to read the word theater, you are actually unable to read it. Here, this is called a variant of uncertain significance, where this A is replaced by a T, but we don't know whether it affects the function of the protein that has been made. So a variant of uncertain significance for us means to take no action. The vast majority of variants of uncertain significance are not meaningful changes in the genetic code, and they don't have an impact on the protein that is produced. And once again, to review, a misspelling or an error in the code is when we have a mutation and we know that it has an important consequence and that the protein that's made does not function. So those are the types of genetic test results that people can have. A variant of uncertain significant result, which means it's not actionable. A mutation, which means that there is a problem or error in the genetic code. And then normal variability or normal variation. So theater both mean the same exact thing. This could have come back spelled either way, but it is still within normal. So that's the review of the types of results that people can have when they undergo germline genetic testing, and also what we're looking at when we do genetic testing. I'll now go into how we do genetic testing and some of the advances in cancer genetic testing. This is a timeline of genetic technology and the advancements in genetic testing that have occurred over the past 10 years. So in The original type of genetic testing that was done was called Sanger sequencing, and it was doing just a spell check. However, you could have different words in the sentence out of order, and because it was just a spell check, it would be missed by Sanger sequencing. And so deletion duplication analysis was added in 2006. Next generation sequencing began in about 2010, and this is a new type of technology or modality that allows or makes for much faster and cheaper genetic testing. So when you talk to people who had genetic testing in 2004, they'll talk about how it was very expensive, thousands and thousands of dollars just to look for two genes. But that has changed quite a bit, and next generation sequencing really has resulted in more people having access to germline genetic testing. Next generation sequencing led to our ability to do panel-based testing. So that means that all on the same blood draw, the same test requisition form, we can analyze tens, if not hundreds, of genes at the same time, all for the same very low cost. And currently we're doing testing that where we look at the DNA, but also the RNA. So the step right after the DNA step before you get to the protein being made is what is becoming or is emerging as the standard of care now. Multi-gene panel tests, as I mentioned, allow us to look at really dozens of genes related to cancer risk at the same time. Again, the benefits of this are that it has a fast turnaround time, and it costs the same as testing just two genes. There are benefits and limitations, and we'll go over those now. Some of the benefits are that for people where we've tested them in the past and haven't had an explanation, we now have one. It also doesn't require us to sort of guess which genes we're the most concerned about. It allows us to look at all genes that are important for cancer together at one time. What this can mean is, though, that we find unexpected mutations. So mutations in genes we weren't thinking about or expecting. This type of testing allows us to look at both genes that are associated with very high risk for the development of cancers, but also for genes that play a role in cancer development, but are associated with less high risk. So we call this moderate risk alleles. So high penetrance genes are ones where the relative risk of developing a cancer is well over four times the rate of someone who doesn't have that change, and moderate risk tends to be about two times the rate. So when we look at many genes, we often get more information. Sometimes we get more questions. So cancer risk may not be very high, as we discussed, especially with the moderate risk genes. Sometimes if we do find a moderate risk mutation, this may not change sort of what surgery is recommended for someone or what therapy will be used for them. Cancer risk may be unclear, so we may find a mutation in a gene that we're still learning about, that it's a gene that is, for example, mutations in that gene are rare or only newly described, and so we are still trying to determine how people, for example, with mutations in that gene, should be cared for. Should they have bilateral mastectomies, or should they have lumpectomy? And obviously this is a conversation that occurs between one's doctor and oneself in the context of having these genetic test results. And also the important thing is we're still learning. So as you've seen, there's been an explosion in what we're able to do, but what we're recommending for people today based on the results of a genetic test may not be exactly what we're recommending 5 years from now. And so we do recommend that people, anybody who has a mutation or who has a striking personal or family history of cancers, undergo genetic testing more than once. So while your genes don't change, for example, your what we're able to detect does change. And so we always say people should check in with their genetic counselor every 3 to 5 years to make sure that their testing is up to date and adequate, or whether they would benefit from additional genetic testing at this point in time. So practical aspects of genetic testing. So insurance coverage, this comes up a lot. Private insurance, the coverage varies by one's insurance company, but in general, genetic testing is covered for patients with cancer. Some companies have lists of criteria for coverage, meaning age at diagnosis, number of affected family members. And so we know that these can often be used to limit access to germline genetic testing. However, we think that the coverage of testing has improved markedly. Medicare. So Medicare has their own specific rules. The person with cancer is the one who will be covered by Medicare. So Medicare generally does not cover unaffected individuals. There are also a number of laboratories that have now partnered to make testing of individuals who have cancer and are on Medicare to make testing basically low to no cost. And then for Medicaid, genetic testing is often covered because of agreements with Medicaid and some of the testing laboratories. Most people get their genetic testing covered now, and testing it has decreased so that the maximum out-of-pocket cost for someone where it's not covered would be $250. So this is one major improvement, a major change in genetic testing, is that now it's actually accessible. Practical aspects of genetic testing. Patients can also be concerned about insurance discrimination. We can be very reassuring about that. So the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act of 2008 is a federal law that protects the use of genetic test results as a pre-existing condition by health insurance companies and by employers. And then there are life, disability, long-term care insurance, while there are no federal protections in place to prevent these companies from using genetic test results, there are laws in the state of Massachusetts which prevent the use of genetic information from being used to discriminate against individuals. And again, if someone already or has a pre-existing policy in place, they are likely protected. For those who have cancer or with cancer, generally, this does not make a difference in terms of their ability to obtain insurance or keep insurance. In general, you will not lose your insurance by having germline genetic testing. Often genetic testing is done through a genetic counselor. What is a genetic counselor? A genetic counselor is a healthcare professional with a master's degree, and they're really translators of genetic information and genetic material. They advocate for patients, they help to perform risk estimation, they provide psychosocial support and education and diagnosis. So when someone is identified as having a mutation, they can help with all of these things, and they can also help patients to discuss this with their family members and to alert their family members as to what is going on in the family so that we can advocate for our own sort of best health and also for health for our relatives. So thank you for allowing me to discuss germline genetic testing or talk to you about germline genetic testing. This is my email address. Feel free to reach out to me. If you need a genetic counselor, you can go to www.nsgc.org. You can visit Dana-Farber and call 617-632-2178 if you're interested in learning more about cancer genetic testing. Thank you.